The 15th Book of the Odysseys of Homer, translated by George Chapman. The Argument. Minerva to his native seat exhorts Ulysses' son's retreat, in bed and waking. He receives gifts of Atrides, and so leaves the Spartan court, and going aboard doth favorable way afford to Theoclymenus, that was the Argive augur and sought pass, fled for a slaughter he had done. Eumaeus tells Laertes' son how he became his father's man, being sold by the Phoenician for some agreed-on faculties, from forth the Syrian isle made prize. Telemachus, arrived at home, doth to Eumaeus's cottage come. Another Argument. Omicron. From Sparta's strand makes safe access to his own land Ulysses. In Lacedaemon, large and apt for dances, Athenian palace her access advances up to the great in soul Ulysses' seed, suggesting his return now fit for deed. She found both him and Nestor's noble son in bed, in front of that fair mansion, Nestorides surprised with pleasing sleep, but on the watch Ulysses' son did keep. Sleep could not enter, cares did so excite his soul, through all the solitary night, for his loved father. To him near she said, Telemachus, 'tis time that now were stayed thy foreign travels, since thy goods are free for those proud men that all will eat from thee. Divide thy whole possessions, and leave thy too late presence nothing to receive. Incite the shrill-voiced Menelaus, then, to send thee to thy native seat again, while thou mayest yet find in her honour strong thy blameless mother, gainst thy father's wrong. For both the father and the brothers too of thy loved mother will not suffer so extended any more her widow's bed, but make her now her richest wooer wed, Eurymachus, who chiefly may augment her gifts, and make her jointure eminent. And therefore haste thee, lest in thy despite thy house stand empty of thy native right. For well thou know'st what mind a woman bears, the house of him, whoever she endears herself in nuptials to, she sees increased, the issue of her first-loved lord deceased forgotten quite, and never thought on more. In thy return, then, the recounted store thou findest reserved, to thy most trusted maid commit in guard, till heaven's powers have purveyed a wife, in virtue and in beauty's grace, of fit sort for thee, to supply her place. And this note more I'll give thee, which repose in sure remembrance. The best sort of those that woo thy mother watchful scouts address, both in the straits of the Ithacensian seas and dusty Samos, with intent to invade and take thy life, ere thy return be made, which yet I think will fail, and some of them that waste thy fortunes taste of that extreme they plot for thee. But keep off far from shore, and day and night sail, for a foreright blore, whoever of the immortals that vow guard and scape to thy return will see prepared. As soon as thou arriv'st, dismiss to town thy ship and men, and first of all make down to him that keeps thy swine, and doth conceive a tender care to see thee well survive. There sleep, and send him to the town, to tell the chaste Penelope that safe and well thou liv'st in his charge, and that Pylos's sands the place contained from whence thy person lands. Thus she to large Olympus made assent, when with his heel a little touch he lent to Nestor's son, whose sleep's sweet chains he loosed, bade rise and see in chariot enclose their one-hoofed horse, that they might straight be gone. No such haste, he replied. Night holds her throne, and dims all way to course of chariot. The morn will soon get up, nor see forgot the gifts with haste, that will, I know, be rich, and put into our coach with gracious speech by lance-famed Menelaus. Not a guest shall touch at his house, but shall store his breast with fit mind of an hospitable man, to last as long as any daylight can his eyes recomfort, in such gifts as he will proofs make of his hearty royalty. He had no sooner said, but up arose Aurora, that the golden hills repose. And Menelaus, good at martial cries, from Helen's bed raised, to his guest supplies his first appearance, whose repair made known till Ulysses' loved son. On his robe was thrown about his gracious body, his cloak cast athwart his ample shoulders, and in haste abroad he went, and did the king accost. Atrides, guarded with heaven's deified host, grant now remission to my native right, my mind now urging mine own house's sight. "Nor will I stay," said he, "thy person long, since thy desires to go are grown so strong. I should myself be angry to sustain the like detention urged by other men. Who loves a guest past mean will hate. The mean in all acts bears the best estate. Alike ill 'tis to thrust out such a guest as would not go, as to detain the rest. We should a guest love while he loves to stay, and, when he likes not, give him loving way. Yet suffer so that we may gifts impose in coach to thee, which ere our hands enclose thine eyes shall see, lest else our loves may gloze. Besides, I'll cause our women to prepare what our house yields, and merely so much fare as may suffice for health. Both well will do, both for our honour and our profit too. And serving strength with food, you after may as much earth measure as will match the clay. If you will turn your course from sea, and go through Greece and Argos, that myself may so keep kind way with thee, I'll join horse, and guide to our human cities. Nor ungratified will any one remit us. Some one thing will each present us, that along may bring our pass with love, and prove our virtues blazed, a cauldron or a tripod, richly brazed, two mules, a bowl of gold that hath his price heightened with emblems of some rare device." The wise prince answered, "I would gladly go home to mine own, and see that governed so that I may keep what I for certain hold, not hazard that for only hoped for gold. I left behind me none so always fit to give it guard, as mine own trust with it. Besides, in this broad course which you propose, my father seeking I myself may lose." When this the shrill-voiced Menelaus heard, he charged his queen and maids to see prepared breakfast, of what the whole house held for best. To him rose Eteoneus from his rest, whose dwelling was not far off from the court, and his attendants his command did sort with kindling fires, and furthering all the roast, in act of whose charge no time he lost. Himself then to an odorous room descended, whom Megapenthe and his queen attended. Come to his treasury, a two-eared cup he choosed of all, and made his son bear up a silver bowl. The queen then taking stand aside her chest, where by her own fair hand lay vests of all hues wrought, she took out one most large, most artful, chiefly fair, and shone like to a star, and lay of all the last. Then through the house with either's gifts they passed, when to Ulysses' son Atrides said, "Telemachus, since so entirely swayed thy thoughts are with thy vowed return now tendered, may Juno's thundering husband see it rendered perfect at all parts, action answering thought. Of all the rich gifts, in my treasure sought, I give thee here the most in grace and best, a bowl but silver, yet the brims compressed with gold, whose fabric his desert doth bring from Vulcan's hand, presented by the king and great hero of Sidonia's state, when at our parting he did consummate his whole housekeeping. This do thou command." This said, he put the round bowl in his hand, and then his strong son Megapenthe placed the silver cup before him, amply graced with work and lustre. Helen, standing by, and in her hand the robe, her housewifery, his name remembering, said, "And I present, love son, this gift to thee, the monument of so many loved Helen's hands, which at the knitting of thy nuptial bands present thy wife. In mean space may it lie by thy loved mother, but to me apply thy pleasure in it, and thus take thy way to thy fair house and country's wished stay." Thus gave she to his hands the veil, and he the acceptation authored joyfully, which in the chariot's chest Pisistratus placed with the rest and held miraculous. The yellow-headed king then led them all to seats and thrones placed in his spacious hall. The handmaid water brought, and gave its stream from out a fair and golden ewer to them, from whose hands to a silver cauldron fled the troubled wave. A bright board then she spread, on which another reverend dame set bread, to which more servants store of victuals served. Eteoneus was the man that curved, and Megapenthe filled them all their wine. All fed and drank, till all felt care decline for those refreshings, Both the guests did go to horse and coach, and forth the portico a little issued, when the yellow king brought wine himself, that, with an offering to all the gods, they might their journey take. He stood before the gods, and thus he spake: "Farewell, young princes, to grave Nestor's ear this salutation from my gratitude bear, that I profess, in all our Ilian wars, he stood a careful father to my cares." To whom the wise Ulyssides replied: "With all our utmost shall be signified, Jove kept Atrides, your right royal will, and would to God I could as well fulfill mine own mind's gratitude for your free grace, in telling to Ulysses, in the place of my return, in what accomplished kind I have obtained the office of a friend at your deservings, whose fair end you crowned with gifts so many and of such renown." His wish that he might find in his retreat his father safe returned, to so repeat the king's love to him, was saluted thus. An eagle rose, and in her sears did truss a goose all white and huge, a household one, which men and women, crying out upon, pursued, but she, being near the guests, her flight made on their right hand, and kept still foreright before their horses, which, observed by them, the spirits in all their minds took joy's extreme, which Nestor's son thus questioned: "Jove kept king, yield your grave thoughts, if this ostentful thing, this eagle and this goose, touch us or you?" He put to study, and not knowing how to give fit answer, Helen took on her the ostent's solution, and did this prefer: "Hear me, and I will play the prophet's part, as the immortals cast it in my heart, and as, I think, will make the true sense known. As this Jove's bird, from out the mountains flown, where was her eyrie, and whence rose her race, trussed up this goose, that from the house did graze, so shall Ulysses, coming from the wild of seas and sufferings, reach, unreconciled, his native home, where even this hour he is, and on those house-fed wooers those wrongs of his will shortly wreak with all their miseries." "Oh," said Telemachus, "if Saturnian Jove to my desires thy dear presage approve, when I arrive I will perform to thee my daily vows, as to a deity." This said, he used his scourge upon the horse, that through the city freely made their course to field, and all day made that first speed good. But when the sun set, and obscureness stood in each man's way, they ended their access at Pharos, in the house of Diocles, son to Orsilochus, Alpheus's seed, who gave them guest rites, and sleep's natural need they that night served there. When Aurora rose, they joined their horse, took coach, and did dispose their course for Pylos, whose high city soon they reached. Nor would Telemachus be won to Nestor's house, and therefore ordered thus his speech to Nestor's son, Pisistratus: "How shall I win thy promise to a grace that I must ask of thee? We both embrace the names of bedfellows, and in that name will glory as an adjunct of our fame, our father's friendship, our own equal age, and our joint travel, may the more engage our mutual concord. Do not then essay, my god-loved friend, to lead me from my way to my near ship, but take a course direct, and leave me there, lest the old sire's respect in his desire to love me hinder so my way for home, that have such need to go." This said, Nestorides held all discourse in his kind soul, how best he might enforce both promise and performance, which, at last, he vowed to venture, and directly cast his horse about to fetch the ship and shore. Where come, his friend's most lovely gifts he bore aboard the ship, and in her hind deck placed the veil that Helen's curious hand had graced, and Menelaus's gold, and said: "Away, nor let thy men in any least date stay, but quite put off, ere I get home, and tell the old duke you are past, for passing well I know his mind to exceed all force of any prayer, that he will stay your course, himself make hither, all your course call back, and when he hath you, have no thought to rack him from his bounty, and to let you part without a present, but be vexed at heart with both our pleadings, if we once put move the least repression of his fiery love." Thus took he coach, his fair-maned steed scourged on, along the Pylian city, and anon his father's court reached, while Ulysses' son bade board and arm, which with a thought was done. His rowers set, and he rich odors firing in his hind deck for his secure retiring, to great Athenia, to his ship came flying a stranger and a prophet, as relying on wished passage, having newly slain a man at Argos. Yet his race's vein flowed from Melampus, who in former date in Pylos lived, and had a huge estate, but fled his country and the punishing hand of great-souled Neleus, in a foreign land, from that most famous mortal, having held a world of riches, nor could be compelled to render restitution in a year. In mean space, living as close prisoner in the court of Phylacus, and for the sake of Neleus's daughter mighty cares did take, together with a grievous languor sent from grave Erinnys, that did much torment his vexed conscience. Yet his life's expense he scaped, and drave the loud-voiced oxen thence, to breed sheep Pylos, bringing vengeance thus his foul demerit to great Neleus, and to his brother's house reduced his wife, who yet from Pylos did remove his life for feed-horse Argos, where his fate set down a dwelling for him, and in much renown made govern many Argives, where a spouse he took to him, and built a famous house. There he had borne to him Antiphates, and forceful Mantius. To the first of these was great Oecleus born. Oecleus gat Amphiaraus, that the popular state had all their health in, whom even from his heart Jove loved, and Phoebus in the whole desert of friendship held him. Yet not blessed so much that age's threshold he did ever touch, but lost his life by female bribery. Yet two sons authored his posterity, Alcmaeon and renowned Amphilochus. Mantius had issue of Polyphidius and Clytus, but Aurora ravished him, for excellence of his admired limb, and interested him amongst the gods. His brother knew men's good and bad abodes the best of all men, after the decease of him that perished in unnatural peace at spacious Thebes. Apollo did inspire his knowing soul with a prophetic fire, who, angry with his father, took his way to Hyperesia, where, making stay, he prophesied to all men, and had there a son called Theoclymenus, who here came to Telemachus, and found aboard himself at sacrifice, whom in a word he thus saluted. O friend, since I find, even here at ship, a sacrificing mind inform your actions, by your sacrifice, and by the worthy choice of deities to whom you offer, by yourself, and all these men that serve your course maritimal, tell one that asks the truth, nor give it glows, both who and whence you are, from what seed rose your royal person, and what city's towers hold habitation to your parents' powers. He answered, Stranger, the sure truth is this, I am of Ithaca. My father is, or was, Ulysses, but austere death now takes his state from him, whose event to know himself being long away, I set forth thus with ship and soldiers. Theoclymenus as freely said, And I to thee am fled from forth my country, for a man struck dead by my unhappy hand, who was with me of one self-tribe, and of his pedigree are many friends and brothers, and the sway of Achaive kindred reacheth far away, from whom, because I fear their spleen suborn blood and black fate against me, being born to be a wanderer among foreign men, make thy fair ship my rescue, and sustain my life from slaughter. Thy deservings may perform that mercy, and to them I pray. Nor will I bar, said he, thy will to make my means an equal ship thy aid, but take, with what we have here in all friendly use, thy life from any violence that pursues. Thus took he in his lance, and it extended aloft the hatches, which himself ascended. The prince took seat at stern, and on his right hand set Theoclymenus, and gave command to all his men to arm, and sea made fast, amidst the hollow keel, the beechen mast with able hawsers, hoise sail, launch, which soon he saw obeyed. And then his ship did run a merry course. Blue-eyed Minerva sent a foreright gale, tumultuous, vehement, along the air, that her ways utmost yield the ship might make, and plough the brackish field. Then set the sun, and night blacked all the ways. The ship, with Jove's wind winged, where the Epeian sways, fetched Pharus first, then Elis the divine, and then for those isles made, that seaward shine for form and sharpness like a lance's head, about which lay the wooers ambushed. on which he rushed to try if he could scape his plotted death, or serve her treacherous rape. And now return we to Eumaeus's shed, where, at their food with others marshalled, Ulysses and his noble herdsmen sate, to try if whose love's curious estate stood firm to his abode, or felt it fade, and so would take each best cause to persuade his guest to town. Ulysses thus contends: "Hear me, Eumaeus, and ye other friends. Next morn to town I covet to be gone, to beg some other's alms, not still charge one. Advise me well then, and as well provide I may be fitted with an honest guide. For through the streets, since need will have it so, I tread, to find if any will bestow a dish or drink on me, or a bit of bread, till to Ulysses' house I may be led, and there I'll tell all wise Penelope news, mixed with the wooers' pride, and, since they use to fare above the full, their hands excite to some small feast from out their infinite. For which I'll wait and play the serving man, fairly enough, command the most they can. For I will tell thee, note me well and hear, that if the will of heaven's messenger, who to the works of men of any sort can grace infuse and glory, nothing short am I of him that doth to most aspire in any service, as to build a fire, to cleave sear wood, to roast or boil their meat, to wait at board, mix wine, or know the neat, or any work in which the poor called worst, to serve the rich called best, in fate are forced." He, angry with him, said, "Alas, poor guest, why did this counsel ever touch thy breast? Thou seek'st thy utter spoil beyond all doubt, if thou giv'st venture on the wooer's route, whose wrong and force affects the iron heaven. Their light delights are far from being given to such grave servitors. Youths richly tricked in coats or cassocks, locks divinely slicked, and looks most rapting, ever have the gift to taste their crown cups, and full trenchers shift. Their tables ever like their glasses shine, loaded with bread, with varied flesh and wine. And thou go thither? Stay, for here do none grudge at thy presence, nor myself, nor one of all I feed. But when Ulysses' son again shall greet us, he shall put thee on both coat and cassock, and thy quick retreat set where thy heart and soul desire thy seat." Industrious Ulysses gave reply: "I still much wish that heaven's chief deity love thee as I do, that hast eased my mind of woes and wanderings never yet confined. Naught is more wretched in a human race than country's want, and shift from place to place. But for the baneful belly men take care beyond good counsel, whosoever are in compass of the wants it undergoes by wanderings, losses, or dependent woes. Excuse me, therefore, if I erred at home, which since thou wilt make here, as overcome with thy command for stay, I'll take on me cares appertaining to this place, like thee. Does then Ulysses' sire and mother breathe, both whom he left in the age next door to death? Or are they breathless, and descended where the dark house is, that never day doth clear?" "Laertes lives," said he, "but every hour beseecheth Jove to take from him the power that joins his life and limbs. For with a moan that breeds a marvel, he laments his son deprived by death, and adds to that another of no less depth for that dead son's dead mother, whom he a virgin wedded, which the more makes him lament her loss, and doth deplore yet more her miss, because her womb the truer was to his brave son, and his slaughter slew her. Which last love to her doth his life engage, and makes him live an undigested age. Oh, such a death she died, as never may seize any one that here beholds the day, that either is to any man a friend, or can a woman kill in such a kind. As long as she had being, I would be a still inquirer, since 'twas dear to me, though death to her, to hear his name, when she heard of Ulysses, for I might be bold. She brought me up, and in her love did hold my life, compared with long-veiled Ctimene, her youngest issue, and in some small degree her daughter yet preferred, a brave young dame. And when of youth the dearly loved flame was lighted in us, marriage did prefer the maid to Samos, whence was sent for her infinite riches, when the queen bestowed a fair new suit, new shoes, and all, and vowed me to the field, but passing loath to part, as loving me more than she loved her heart. And these I want now, but their business grows upon me daily, which the gods impose. To whom I hold all, give account to them, for I see none left to the diadem that may dispose all better. So I drink and eat of what is here, and whom I think, worthy or reverend, I have given to, still, these kinds of guest rites, for the household ill, which, where the queen is, riots, takes her still from thought of these things. Nor is it delight to hear from her plight of or worker word, the wooers spoil all. But yet my men will board her sorrows often with discourse of all, eating and drinking of the festival that there is kept, and after bring to field such things as servants make their pleasures yield. O me, Eumeus, said Laertes' son, hast thou then erred so of a little one, like me from friends and country? Pray thee say, and say a truth, doth vast destruction lay her hand upon the wide-wayed seat of men? Where dwelt thy sire and reverend mother then, that thou art spared there? Or else, set alone in guard of beeves or sheep, set the enemy on, surprised and shipped, transferred and sold thee here? He that bought thee paid well, yet bought not dear. Since thou inquirest of that, my guest, said he, herein be silent, and mean space sit free in use of these cups to thy most delights. Unspeakable in length now are the nights. Those that affect sleep yet, to sleep have leave. Those that affect to hear, their hearers give. But sleep not ere your hour. Much sleep doth grieve. Whoever lists to sleep, away to bed, together with the morning raise his head, together with his fellows break his fast, and then his lord's herd drive to their repast. We two, still in our tabernacle here, drinking and eating, will our bosoms cheer with memories and tales of our annoys. Betwixt his sorrows every human joys, he most who most hath felt and furthest erred, and now thy will to act shall be preferred. There is an isle above Ortygia, if thou hast heard, they call it Syria, where, once a day, the sun moves backward still. 'Tis not so great as good, for it doth fill the fields with oxen, fills them still with sheep, fills roofs with wine, and makes all corn there cheap. No dearth comes ever there, nor no disease that doth with hate us wretched mortals seize. But when men's varied nations, dwelling there in any city, entered the aged year, the silver bow-bearer, the sun, and she that bears as much renown for archery, stoop with their painless shafts and strike them dead, as one would sleep and never keep the bed. In this isle stand two cities, betwixt whom all things that of the soil's fertility come in two parts are divided. And both these my father ruled, Ctesias Ormenides, a man like the immortals. With these states the cross-biting Phoenicians trafficked rates of infinite merchandise in ships brought there, in which they then were held exempt from peer. There dwelt within my father's house a dame, born a Phoenician, skilful in the frame of noble housewiferies, right tall and fair. Her the Phoenician great wench net-layer with sweet words circumvented, as she was washing her linen. To his amorous pass he brought her first, shored from his ship to her, to whom he did his whole life's love prefer. Which of these breast-exposing dames the hearts deceives, though fashioned of right honest parts? He asked her after, what she was and whence. She, passing presently, the excellence told of her father's turrets, and that she might boast herself sprung from the progeny of the rich Sidons, and the daughter was of the much-year-revenued Arabus, but that the Taphian pirates made her prize, as she returned from her field housewiferies. Transferred her hither, and at that man's house where now she lived, for value precious, sold her to the owner. He that stole her love bade her again to her birth-seat remove to see the fair roofs of her friends again, who still held state, and did the port maintain herself reported. She said, be it so, so you and all that in your ship shall row, swear to return me in all safety hence. All swore, the oath passed with every consequence she bade. Be silent now, and not a word do you or any of your friends afford, meeting me afterward in any way, or at the washing fount, lest some display be made and told the old man, and he then kept me straight bound, to you and to your men the utter ruin plotting of your lives. Keep in firm thought, then, every word that strives for dangerous utterance. Haste your ship's full freight of what you traffic for, and let me straight know by some sent friend she hath all in hold, and with myself I'll bring thence all the gold I can by all means finger, and beside I'll do my best to see your freight supplied with some well-weighing burthen of mine own, for I can bring up in-house a great man's son, as crafty as myself, who will with me run every way along, and I will be his leader, till your ship hath made him sure. He will an infinite great price procure, transfer him to what languaged men ye may. This said, she gat her home, and there made stay a whole year with us, goods of great avail their ship enriching. Which now fit for sale, they sent a messenger to inform the dame, and to my father's house a fellow came, full of Phoenician craft, that to be sold a tablet brought, the body all of gold, the verge all amber. This had ocular view, both by my honored mother and the crew of her housemaids, handled and the price beat, asked and promised. And while this device lay thus upon the forge, this jeweler made privy signs, by winks and wiles, to her that was his object, which she took, and he, his sign seeing noted, hied to ship. When she, my hand still taking, as she used to do, to walk abroad with her, conveyed me so abroad with her, and in the portico found cups with tasted viands, which the guests that used to flock about my father's feasts had left. They gone, some to the council court, some to hear news amongst the talking sort, her theft three bowls into her lap conveyed, and forth she went. Nor was my wit so stayed to stay her, or myself. The sun went down, and shadows round about the world were flown, when we came to the haven, in which did ride the swift Phoenician ship, whose fair broadside they boarded straight, took us up, and all went along the moist waves. Wind Saturnius sent. 6 days we day and night sailed, but when Jove put up the seventh day, she that shafts doth love shot dead the woman, who into the pump like to a dopchick dived, and gave a thump in her sad settling. Forth they cast her then to serve the fish and sea calves, no more men, but I was left there with a heavy heart. When wind and water drave them quit apart their own course, and on Ithaca they fell, and there poor me did to Laertes sell, and thus these eyes the sight of this isle proved. Eumaeus, he replied, thou much hast moved the mind in me with all things thou hast said, and all the sufferance on thy bosom laid. But, truly, to thy ill hath Jove joined good, that one whose veins are served with human blood hath bought thy service, that gives competence of food, wine, cloth to thee, and sure the expense of thy life's date here is of good desert, whose labors not to thee alone impart sufficient food and housing, but to me. Where I through many a heaped humanity have hither erred, where though like thee not sold, nor stayed like thee yet, nor not needful hold. This mutual speech they used, nor had they slept much time, before the much near morning leapt to her fair throne, and now struck sail the men that served Telemachus, arrived just then near his loved shore, where now they stooped the mast, made to the port with oars and anchor cast, made fast the ship, and then ashore they went, dressed supper, filled wine, when, their appetite spent, Telemachus commanded they should yield the ship to the owner, while himself at field would see his shepherds. When light drew to end he would his gift see, and to town descend, and in the morning at a feast bestow rewards for all their pains. And whither now, said Theoclymenus, my loved son, shall I address myself? Whose mansion of all men in this rough-hewn isle shall I direct my way to, or go readily to thy house and thy mother? He replied, another time I'll see you satisfied with my house entertainment, but as now you should encounter none that could bestow your fit entreaty, and, which less grace were, you could not see my mother, I not there. For she's no frequent object, but apart keeps from her wooers, wooed with her desert, up in her chamber at her housewifery. But I'll name one to whom you shall apply direct repair, and that's Eurymachus, renowned descent to wise Polybus, a man whom the Ithacensians look on now as on a god, since he of all that woo is far superior man, and likest far to wed my mother, and as circular be in that honour as Ulysses was. But heaven housed Jove knows the yet hidden pass of her disposure, and on them he may a blacker sight bring than her nuptial day. As this he uttered, on his right hand flew a saker, sacred to the god of view, that in his talons trussed and plumed a dove, the feathers round the ship did rove, and on Telemachus fell, whom the augur then took fast by the hand, withdrew him from his men, and said, "Telemachus, this hawk is sent from God. I knew it for a sure ostent when first I saw it. Be you well assured that will no wooer be by heaven endured to rule in Ithaca above your race, but your powers ever fill the regal place." "I wish to heaven," said he, "thy word might stand. Thou then shouldst soon acknowledge from my hand such gifts and friendship as would make thee guest met and saluted as no less than blessed." This said, he called Piraeus, Clytus's son, his true associate, saying, "Thou hast done, of all my followers to the Pylian shore, my will in chief in other things. Once more be chiefly good to me. Take to thy house this loved stranger, and be studious to embrace and greet him with thy greatest fare, till I myself come and take off thy care." The famous for his lance said, "If your stay take time for life here, this man's care all lay on my performance, nor what fits a guest shall any penury withhold his feast." Thus took he ship, bade them board, and away. They boarded, sat, but did their labor stay till he had decked his feet and reached his lance. They to the city, he did straight advance up to his sties, where swine lay for him store, by whose side did his honest swineherd snore, till his short cares his longest nights had ended, and nothing worse to both his lords intended. End of the 15th book.